read Matthew 10, and look down at, basically, I mean, we read it already, but I'm going to explain. Jesus is kind of, not necessarily warning the disciples, just kind of telling them what's going to come to pass because they're doing God's work. And we're going to start reading in Matthew 22, Matthew 10, verse 22. And it says, "And ye shall be hated of all men for my name's sake, but he that endureth to the end shall be saved. But when they persecute you in this city, flee you into another. For verily I say unto you, ye shall not have gone over the cities of Israel till the Son of Man be come." And the first point I want to make is that he's telling them that people are going to hate him for doing God's work. And in verse 25, just jump down, it says, "It is enough for the disciple that he be as his master and the servant as his Lord. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebub, how much more shall they call them of his own household?" So, in other words, these people not only hate the disciples, or it actually, what I thought was interesting, it refers to them as apostles as well, but and this is before, I believe, Jesus rises from the dead. But basically, what we're supposed to get out of this is that people are going to say that we're of the devil. Just like they said that Jesus was of the devil, the scribes and the Pharisees, these same people, these same types of people are going to say that we're of the devil. And they're going to hate us. They're going to persecute us. They're going to hurt us. And it says in verse 25, or sorry, we just read 25. Look it down to 28. It says, "And fear not them which kill the body, but are not able to kill the soul, but rather fear him which is able to destroy both soul and body in hell." So the title of my sermon, or really the topic of my sermon, is fearing the Lord. Okay, we're not supposed to fear man and what man can do to us. We're supposed to only fear God. And, you know, there's a famous verse, you know, he's not given us a spirit of fear. But what I'm going to show you is that it's right, and we're supposed to fear the Lord. And it's one of the only things that I feel justifies a lot of the things that we even do as a Christian. You know, if you don't fear the Lord, what's the point of coming to church? If you don't fear the Lord, what's the point of going soul winning? If you don't fear the Lord, what's the point of reading this book? See, the fear of the Lord, and we're about to get into it, is basically the basis of all Christianity, in my opinion, other than the fact that Jesus died for our sins. So I'm going to read you a verse. Go turn to Proverbs 1, and I'm going to read Proverbs 14. And the first, I guess, point I'm going to make is, what is the fear of the Lord? I'm just going to go over what the Bible teaches is the fear of the Lord, and we're just going to go from there. It's going to be a lot of turning, a lot of flipping, so just be ready for that. Proverbs 14:26 says, "In the fear of the Lord is strong confidence, and his children shall have a place of refuge. The fear of the Lord is a fountain of life, to depart from the snares of death." The fear of the Lord is a very positive thing. And the fear of the Lord, the Bible says, gives us confidence, and it's a fountain of life. One of the first points I'm going to make is that the fear of the Lord, and we're about to read it in Proverbs 1, the Bible teaches it's the beginning of knowledge, okay? And one of the two things that I thought of when reading that was just the fact that when we go soul winning, the very first thing we teach people is that we're sinners and we're going to hell. You know, that the reason we do that, I believe, is to instill some fear of the Lord. In Proverbs 1, we're going to read in 7 through 8. It says, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction." The fear of the Lord, point blanks, it is the beginning of knowledge. It's the first thing. And the reason we show people soul winning, the first thing is not, you know, Jesus died on the cross, you have eternal life. It's to help them understand that there's a consequence for our actions, and that consequence is eternal fire, and that consequence is an angry God. And the reason we do that is because the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Now, also, that only not applies to people who are not Christians, but it also applies to new Christians and Christians like us. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of all knowledge. Everything that we know about God, should come from the first thing that we did, and that was the fear of the Lord. See, like I talked about before, what's the point of reading this Bible every day if I don't fear what God's going to do to me if I don't? What's the point of coming to church every Thursday, Sunday, you know, homeschool field trips? What's the point if God's not going to do anything if we don't? The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. It's one of the most important things in a Christian's life. Turn over to, keep your finger in Proverbs 1 and turn to Proverbs 9. This is just another passage to show you that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Proverbs 9, verse 10. It says, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the holy is understanding." So, again, it's just proving, I'm just trying to prove that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. That is what the fear of the Lord is. And I think the Bible's pretty clear about that. And the beginning of knowledge, what is knowledge? It's obviously in this book. It doesn't come from anywhere else. It doesn't come from a textbook. It doesn't come from, you know, school, years and years of school. The knowledge that the Bible's talking about is this knowledge, the knowledge of God, and the beginning of knowledge is the fear of the Lord. Okay? I think that's pretty clear. Now, if you look down Proverbs 1, again, if you flip back to Proverbs 1, and verse 27, I think I wrote that down wrong. Let's see. Let's just read it and see what's there. Proverbs 1, verse 27. The Bible reads, "When your fear cometh as desolation, and your destruction cometh as a whirlwind, when distress and anguish cometh upon you, then shall they call upon me, but I will not answer. They shall seek me early, but they shall not find me, for that they hated knowledge and did not choose the fear of the Lord." See, the Bible teaches that the fear of the Lord, the fear of the Lord and knowledge are just intermingled, okay? And if you hate knowledge, you don't fear the Lord, okay? If you don't want to get into this book and know what it says, if you don't want to come to church and learn about the Word of God, then you don't fear the Lord. If you don't seek after knowledge, you don't fear the Lord properly. You might, you know, you probably feared Him because you didn't want to go to hell, but that's about as far as you went with it. And the Bible's saying that if you hate knowledge, for they hated knowledge and did not choose the fear of the Lord. Okay? Now, that's the first thing that the Bible says is the fear of the Lord. The second thing that the Bible calls the fear of the Lord is Proverbs 8. Turn to Proverbs 8:13. Now, I'm going to prove that, yeah, people might say they're seeking after knowledge. They might say they fear the Lord. But most Christianity is not doing this one. Okay? Proverbs 8, verse 13. It says, "The fear of the Lord is to hate evil. Pride and arrogancy, the evil way, and the forward mouth do I hate." So, not only are we supposed to be knowledgeable, not only are we supposed to seek after knowledge, and I'm going to get it more into that, but we are supposed to hate evil. It says the fear of the Lord is the fear or the to hate evil. And it says pride, arrogancy, and the evil way, and the forward mouth do I hate. See, the fear of the Lord is to hate evil, because if we didn't hate evil and we just kind of stuck with them, we have no fear of God. See, God can destroy our lives. If he really wanted to, he could burn this building down. He could make our car not work. He can burn our house down. He can destroy our lives. And if we properly hate evil and we separate ourselves from that, then we shouldn't have any reason to worry about what God will do to us. But the thing is that people don't hate evil. And that's why Christianity is in the state that it is in today. It's kind of sad, but we're just going to go through these. So, pride, okay? In James 4, it says, "But he giveth more grace, wherefore he saith, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble." If God resists the proud, why wouldn't we resist the proud? I mean, obviously, you know, we're going to knock on everyone's door. We're going to preach the gospel to every creature. But I'm not going to be buddy-buddy with someone who's just, I'm this hot shot. I got a good job. You know, all my kids are perfect. And all they do is boast about themselves. I'm not going to be friends with that person. But I will try and give that person the gospel. I'll love that person. But the thing is that whenever people are marching down the street with pride flags, I don't have to love them. The Bible says that I should hate that. I should hate pride. Okay, now let's look at arrogancy. Okay, so it says pride, arrogancy. Let's look at arrogancy. The Bible says in 1 Samuel 2:3, you don't have to turn there. I just want to show you that arrogancy and pride kind of go hand in hand. It says, talk no more exceeding proudly. Let not arrogancy come out of your mouth, for the Lord is a God of knowledge, and by him actions are weighed. So I just wanted to, I put that there just to show you that pride and arrogancy kind of go hand in hand. There is no such thing as arrogancy without pride, and there's no such thing as pride without arrogancy. And that's just what I got out of it. So turn to Deuteronomy 32. Deuteronomy 32. And I just want to, we're going to be talking about the forward mouth, what that means, okay? Because a lot of people think it's another word for pride or arrogancy, but I found something a little different. I mean, I could be wrong, but I do think it's something a little different. And we're just going to, in Deuteronomy 32, we're just going to see how much God hates forward people. We're going to start in verse 20. 32, verse 20. Deuteronomy 32, verse 20. It says, "And he said, I will hide my face from them. I will see that their end shall be, for they are a very forward generation, children in whom is no faith. They have moved me to jealousy with that which is not God. They have provoked me to an anger with their vanities, and I will move them to jealousy with those which are not a people. I will provoke them to anger with a foolish nation. For a fire is kindled in my anger, and shall burn unto the lowest hell, and shall consume the earth with her increase, and set on fire the foundations of the mountains. I will heap mischief upon them. I will spend mine arrows upon them. They shall be burnt with hunger, and devoured with burning heat, and with bitter destruction. I will also send the teeth of beasts upon them with the poison of serpents of the dust." So God obviously clearly does not like these forward people. Okay, and that's really what I wanted to show you, is just that God really, really does not like forward people. And what I got out of it, if you turn to 2 Samuel 22, 2 Samuel 22, see, we saw that they did things that they brought God to jealousy for things that were not of God. I think that a forward person is someone, I read the dictionary definition, and it's someone who's like, who's contrary, not easy to deal with. But the Bible also kind of has that same definition. It says in 2 Samuel 22, it says, "With the pure thou wilt show thyself pure, and with the froward thou wilt show thyself unsavory." So someone who is froward is unsavory, not a very nice person, probably, I would imagine, just an someone who easily blasphemes God, you know, maybe says, you know, GD all the time or that kind of thing. God says we should hate that stuff and we shouldn't like it. It shouldn't be something that we surround ourselves with. And definitely something that we shouldn't emulate. We shouldn't do that, okay? So go to 2 Kings. We're going to talk about the evil way. What is the evil way? Because that seems kind of vague. So 2 Kings kind of helped me understand this. 2 Kings 17. Sorry. 2 Kings 17. We're going to be in verse 13. And the Bible reads, Yet the Lord testified against Israel and against Judah by all the prophets and by all the seers, saying, Turn ye from your evil ways and keep my commandments and my statutes, according to all the law which I commanded your fathers, in which I sent to you by my servants, the prophets. So we see in this verse, the evil way is opposite or contrary to keeping God's commandments and statutes. And that's the thing that I really want to hone in on for just a second, because a lot of people, whenever you stand up for the Word of God and you tell them what the Bible says, and you tell them that, you know, this is wicked or that is wicked, and you try to defend God's statutes and His commandments, there's a lot of Christians who will tell you, oh, no, that's okay. You know, we should accept that person. For example, you know, obviously, the homosexuals, you know. We get reprimanded for standing on what the Bible says about them. And they say, oh, we're supposed to love them. We're supposed to accept them, you know. And that's something that's obviously wrong. We're supposed to hate evil. Okay? And that's definitely evil. But I want to show you, go to Psalms 36. I'm going to show you that the people who say this stuff don't fear God. Okay? The new evangelical movement doesn't fear God. Psalm 36. Because they'll tell you, we're supposed to love everybody. Just everybody. Even Hitler. I literally had someone tell me that. But the thing is, that's so opposite of what the Bible says. And the Bible says, if I fear God, I'm going to hate evil. And it says, let's read in Proverbs 36, verse 1. It says, the transgression of the wicked saith within my heart that there is no fear of God before his eyes. So underline that. The transgression of the wicked saith within my heart that there is no fear of God before his eyes. For he flattereth himself in his own eyes until his iniquity be found to be hateful. The words of his mouth are iniquity and deceit. He hath left off to be wise and to do good. He deviseth mischief upon his bed. He setteth himself in a way that is not good. He abhorreth not evil. He does not hate evil. And the Bible says that there is no fear of God in his eyes because he doesn't hate evil. See, and I don't know about you, but I'm pretty tired of this new evangelical movement. I wish it would burn to the ground. And these people tell me I have to love everyone and I have to be accepting and compassionate towards wicked, wicked people. But the Bible says that I should hate these people and I should literally want them to die just because that's what God judges and that's what he says. He says that these people shouldn't even be alive. We should not be debating whether or not they should be in our bathrooms. Amen. That's not something that we should be debating. It's not even a question. They shouldn't be allowed in any bathroom. They should be dead. That's what the Bible says. But the thing is that these people want to be so accepting, these pastors mainly, and these pastors want to be so accepting so they can fill the pews, get a big tithe, pay their building off. But the problem with that is that everyone in the pews, they get brainwashed into thinking that it's okay too. And they start accepting it, and they start literally telling you that you're of the devil. Your hate is of the devil, and your anger is of the devil, but it's not true. My anger is from the Lord, and my fear of the Lord makes me hate these people because I don't want to be associated with them. I don't want to be around them. I think it's disgusting, and that's not the only thing, okay? If our society was promoting pedophilia or murderers or anything like that, I'd say the same thing. These people should be dead, okay? It's not just homosexuals, okay? There's a lot of other evil ways that we're supposed to hate, okay? We're supposed to hate the evil way, and the new evangelical movement is an evil way. It's not the right way. The Bible says, it says, let your love be without dissimulation. Abhor that which is evil. Cleave to that which is good. So, and the Bible also says I'm supposed to hate every false way. Okay? If the new evangelical movement is preaching the truth, why don't we go there? It's because it's not the truth, okay? We're supposed to hate every false way, and especially those churches that aren't even churches. I grew up in the new evangelical movement. I went to a non-denominational church, and majority of the people aren't even saved. That's not a church. This is a church. We're all saved. The church is not for people who just come in and want to get saved. It's not a hospital for sinners, okay? I mean, it is kind of for us, I guess. But that's not a way to look at the church. A church, this right here, what we're doing right now, someone preaching and y'all listening, is not to get people saved. It might help someone learn the truth, and then they get saved. But every single that's why we don't get, you know, a 30-minute sermon about salvation every Sunday. Is because it's church is for us. It's for saved people. And you're ruining a whole bunch of people's philosophies whenever you preach behind the pulpit that everything is okay and we're supposed to love everybody. It's not okay. It's super wrong. It makes me angry. It should make you angry because you should fear the Lord. Okay? Now, let's move on. Actually, turn to Psalm 19. Psalm 19. Oh, okay, yeah. So here's what they'll always tell you. I almost missed this. This is a good point. But here's what they'll tell you. You know, your hate and how you don't, you know, support this is evil. You know, you're of the devil. Who's here has heard that? Okay, everybody. So let's look here. Let's see what the Bible says, okay? Because remember, the fear of the Lord is to hate evil, okay? But let's read Psalm 19, starting in verse 9. The fear of the Lord is clean. Do you see that? The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. All of them. See, when we hate evil, when we post a Facebook status nobody likes, it's clean. If we're preaching what the Bible says, it's clean. And the fear of the Lord is clean. And, you know, reading this and doing this study really did encourage me because, you know, whenever your family says, oh, well, maybe you should just be a little bit more loving. Well, no, maybe I should just fear the Lord a little bit more. Maybe I should just realize that the fear of the Lord is clean and I should have nothing to do with what you have to say about it. Because I fear God more than I fear my dad, my mom, my anybody. I fear God more. So let's move on. Now, we talked about what is the fear of the Lord. It's to hate evil. It's the beginning of knowledge. Now let's talk about how to fear the Lord, how to properly fear the Lord. Turn to Proverbs 2. Proverbs 2. Proverbs 2. Let's start reading in verse 1. My son, if thou wilt receive my words and hide my commandments with thee, so that thou incline thine ear unto wisdom, and apply thine heart to understanding. Yea, if thou criest after knowledge, and liftest up thy voice for understanding, if thou seekest her as silver, and searchest for her as for hidden treasure, then shalt thou understand the fear of the Lord, and find the knowledge of God. So, the first thing of how to fear the Lord is to seek knowledge and not just look for it every other day. This is something that you should look for as if you have hidden treasure somewhere. You got a map and you got a big old red X. You should be searching for that red X every day. Okay? Now, it says, if thou seekest her as silver and searchest after her for hidden treasure. I don't know about you, but if there was hidden treasure somewhere, I'd look for it, and I wouldn't just, you know, be a part-time thing. You know, I know we're not supposed to love money, but if I know about this treasure and no one else knows about it, why wouldn't I go look for it? And he uses this illustration to show us that knowledge is more valuable than that worldly treasure. Okay? So even as if there was a hidden treasure somewhere, I should seek after knowledge more than that hidden treasure. Okay? That hidden treasure of knowledge, that is something that we should seek and cry after. Let's read it again. It says, yea, if thou criest after knowledge, if thou yell to God and say, God, give me knowledge, and you cry and you want it, it says in verse 5, then shalt thou understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. The knowledge of God is not going to come to you in the form of a sermon. It will in fractions, don't get me wrong. But the knowledge of God is something that you have to look for. It's something that you have to find. Okay? And it says, read verse 5 again. Then shalt thou understand the fear of the Lord. The fear of the Lord is something you have to understand. I cannot show you how to fear the Lord. That's something you need to figure out. Okay? Because you need to cry for knowledge. I can't sit here and show you every single time the fear of the Lord is mentioned. I just don't have all the time. Anybody that reads their Bible knows that the fear of the Lord is mentioned a lot. Okay? And I cannot prove or show you perfectly how to fear the Lord. But what I can tell you is that if you cry after knowledge, then thou will understand the fear of the Lord. And then you'll find the knowledge of God. A sermon can't do that. Okay? That's something you need to look for. And that's something you need to find. And that's something that you need to do your own study on. Okay? Because all the knowledge of the whole Bible is not contained in all the sermons in the world. There's no way. There's just no way. Or else, why would we have this? If we could just go to church every Sunday, every Thursday, and just understand God, that's not how God ordained it. He wants us to read his word. Okay? Now, you know, the Bible says we should seek after knowledge. And the Bible even says that without wisdom there is no understanding. See, if you look, it says, then shalt thou understand the fear of the Lord. If you're not crying after knowledge, you're not going to understand the fear of the Lord. It's just plain as day. And let's turn to Proverbs 3. Proverbs 3. Proverbs 3, starting in verse 7. Be not wise in thine own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. It shall be health to thy navel and marrow to thy bones. Honor the Lord with all thy substance and with the first fruits of thine increase. So shall thy barns be filled with plenty, and thy presses shall burst out with new wine. My son, despise not the chastening of the Lord, neither be weary of his correction. For whom the Lord loveth, he correcteth, even as a father the son in whom he delighteth. Happy is the man that findeth wisdom, and the man that getteth understanding, for the merchandise of it is better than the merchandise of silver, and the gain thereof than fine gold. She is more precious than rubies, and all the things thou canst desire are not to be compared unto her. What's her? Who's her? Knowledge. Verse 15 says, she is more precious than rubies, and all the things thou canst desire are not to be compared unto her. The Ferrari, you know, the big million-dollar house, whatever you could possibly desire. You cannot hold a candlestick to what knowledge is worth. You can't. It's better than the merchandise of silver and gold. It's better than rubies. It's more important than anything. Knowledge. Knowledge, knowledge, knowledge. We can try to raise our kids, but without the knowledge of God, we're going to fail. We can try to have a successful life. We can try. But without the knowledge of God, we're going to fail. We can try to do these things. But without the fear of the Lord and without knowledge, we cannot be successful as Christians. We just can't. Yeah, the world might be able to be successful. They might have their big house and their fancy car. But we will never be successful. We will never win a soul to Christ if we don't fear God, if we don't do what we're supposed to do, if we don't seek after wisdom. We'll just fail. We'll just utterly fail. And turn to Deuteronomy 17. So how to fear the Lord. We went over to seek knowledge, okay? And if you seek knowledge, there you'll find the knowledge of God and understand the fear of the Lord. And without understanding, without the knowledge of God, you'll never be able to properly fear the Lord. And that's something that you need to look for. That's something that you need to seek. And that's something that everyone in this room should strive for and to want. Deuteronomy 17. Did I already say that? Deuteronomy 17? Okay, Deuteronomy 17. I got to get there. Hold on. Deuteronomy 17, verse 18. Now, obviously, we've talked about where knowledge comes from a little bit. But in Deuteronomy 17, it says, in verse 18, it says, "And it shall be, when he sitteth upon the throne of his kingdom, that he shall write him a copy of this law in a book, out of that which is before the priests, the Levites. And it shall be with him, and he shall read therein all the days of his life, that he may learn to fear the Lord his God, to keep all the words of this law and these statutes to do them." So where do we get knowledge? It says if we read all the days of our life, that is the source of knowledge, not the pulpit. Yeah, we can get knowledge from the pulpit. I'm not trying to diminish what I'm doing right now, obviously. But all I'm saying is that your wisdom, your knowledge, should come mainly from reading all the days of your life. Let's read it again. It says in verse 19, "And it shall be with him, and he shall read therein all the days of his life, that he may," catch that "he may learn to fear the Lord his God." See, fearing the Lord is a growing process. It's not something that just, oh, I fear the Lord today. You need to work at it, and you need to seek knowledge like we just went over. But see, the number one thing of how to fear the Lord is, number one, knowledge, and number two, where to get that knowledge. I mean, you could flip the two, how to get knowledge and, you know, seeking after knowledge, but they're both equally important because knowledge comes from one source. So that's what we need to do every day. And, you know, I'm not perfect at reading my Bible every day as I should, but I don't think anyone really is. Maybe people who are a little bit more mature. I'm still a babe. I'm not afraid to mention that. But that is the source of knowledge. And it says that we may learn to fear the Lord his God and to keep his words of this law and these statutes to do them. See, in order to get the knowledge that we're crying after, we need to read this book. And if you're crying after knowledge, you say, "Oh, I cry after knowledge, but you haven't read your Bible in a month," I don't really believe you. You know, you might be yelling, yeah, but you probably look silly because God's like, "You have a Bible. Just open it." But I mean, like, it's as simple as that. You know, if you're crying after knowledge and you really want knowledge, you're going to read it every day. You're going to seek it every day. So that was the strongest passage I could find on that. So let's move on to the third point. And that's Deuteronomy 6. Deuteronomy 6. Deuteronomy 6. So the first point I made was to seek after knowledge, cry after knowledge. The second point I made is where to find that knowledge and what you should do every day. The third point is keep his commandments. Okay? That's how you fear the Lord. Okay? Because I'll get into it. Let's read it. Starting in verse 1, it says, "Now these are the commandments, the statutes, and the judgments which the Lord your God commanded to teach you, that ye might do them in the land whither you go to possess it, that thou mightest fear the Lord thy God to keep all his statutes and his commandments, which I command thee, thou and thy son's son, all the days of thy life, and that thy days may be prolonged." So, we read there that to fear the Lord, you keep his commandments. See, once you have a little bit more understanding, once you read the Bible and you see that God really wants you to do a lot, you know, a lot of things to please him, obviously not to get saved. There's only one thing you got to do to get saved. But God really does expect a lot from us. And to whom much is given, much is required. And he gives us a whole law that we should keep. And if we see those things, if you hear it behind the pulpit, and you don't keep it, you just keep on living the life that you're going to live, God's going to wear your hind parts out. That's exactly what Pastor Manley preaches all the time. We should fear what God is going to do to us. If we continue to do the things that we know we're not supposed to do, if we continue to read and we see these things that we're not supposed to be doing, and we do it anyway, and we immediately apologize to God, I've been there. I don't know about y'all, but I've been in the middle of doing something I'm not supposed to, and while I'm doing it, I'm like, "God, please forgive me. I'm sorry." We should be just like your father. We should fear the chastisement of the Lord. Yeah, it says despise it not. Don't hate it. But we should. I mean, I don't know about you. I don't want to get chastised by God. I mean, praise God, I'll never go to hell. But I still don't want spankings. I still don't want that. But we should fear what God can do to our lives. Like we talked about a little earlier. You know, we ought to strive for perfection. We ought to strive for that as God's people. We ought to strive to please God and to consider what he thinks. Everything that we do, every step we take, we ought to have our Heavenly Father in mind and say, you know, is that pleasing to God? And not only that, not just, oh, is it pleasing to God? Let me think about it. If you have to think about it, it's probably not pleasing to God, and he's probably going to be really angry at you if you do it, because you know, okay? And I didn't have you keep your finger there, but it says, neither be weary in correction, for whom the Lord loveth, he correcteth. See, God loves us, we all know that, and he will correct us. And the Bible says, let's turn to Psalm 112 so I can just show you. Psalm 112. We ought to strive to please God. And the fear of the Lord goes hand in hand with keeping his commandments. Let's read Psalm 12, starting in verse 1. It says, "Praise ye the Lord. Blessed is the man that feareth the Lord, that delighteth greatly in his commandments." See, if you fear the Lord, you're going to delight in his commandments. Okay? Turn to Deuteronomy 8. I should have probably went to this one first since it was closer. Deuteronomy 8. Starting in verse 6, it says, "Therefore thou shalt keep the commandments of the Lord thy God, to walk in his ways and to fear him." So I just want to show you a couple of verses that prove that the commandments of the Lord and fearing God kind of just go hand in hand. You know, you fear God because you keep the commandments. You keep the commandments because you fear God. They work in tandem together so that you can live a successful Christian life. So that you can do constantly what you're supposed to. So we went through what is the fear of the Lord? The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. It's to hate evil, to hate every false way. We went through how to fear the Lord, cry after knowledge, seek knowledge, where to get that knowledge. We learned that the fear of the Lord is clean. And if we hate evil, God likes it because it's clean. And we keep his commandments because his statutes are pure and righteous altogether. We learned that apply that knowledge and understanding to keep the commandments. Apply that knowledge that you get from reading your Bible every day and keep the commandments to please God and to keep him happy with you. So now we're going to talk about why should I fear the Lord? Okay. Obviously, point number one, we already went over it a bunch, is to keep the commandments. Okay, you fear the Lord so that you keep his commandments and so that God will always be pleased with you. Number two is blessings. Deuteronomy 28, turn there. Deuteronomy 28. Deuteronomy 28, starting in verse 1, it says, "And it shall come to pass, if thou shalt hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe and to do all of his commandments, which I command thee this day, that the Lord thy God will set thee on high above all nations of the earth. And all these blessings shall come on thee and overtake thee. If thou shalt hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God, blessed shalt thou be in the city, and blessed shalt thou be in the field. Blessed shall be the fruit of thy body, and the fruit of thy ground, and the fruit of thy cattle, the increase of thy kind, and the flocks of thy sheep. Blessed shall be thy basket and thy store. Blessed shalt thou be when thou comest in, and blessed shalt thou be when thou goest out. The Lord shall cause thine enemies that rise up against thee to be smitten before thy face. They shall come out against thee one way and flee before thee seven ways." So why we should fear the Lord, number one, to keep his commandments so that he doesn't wear our hind parts out and just get rid of all of our things, is blessing so that we can have more things. Okay, it says in verse 1 and 2, it says in verse 2, it says, "And all these blessings shall come on thee and overtake thee." If you keep the commandments and you hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord, you'll have blessings that you don't even know what to do with. That's what I get. I overtake thee. That's a lot of blessings. I don't know if I've even had blessings like that before. But if you hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord, he says your blessings will overtake thee. That's something that we should all want. I don't know about you, but I want blessings. It says in verse 3, it says, "Blessed shalt thou be in the city, and blessed shalt thou be in the field." The way I imagine that is blessed shalt thou be anywhere. You know, whether you're in the city or you're in the field or you're underwater, whatever, God's going to bless you, okay? It says in verse 4, "Blessed shall be the fruit of thy body and the fruit of thy ground and the fruit of thy cattle, the increase of thy kind and the flocks of thy sheep. Blessed shall be thy basket and thy store." If you follow the commandments, he'll just bless your increase. He'll not only give you blessings to overtake you, I guess you're drowning in blessings, which sounds great, but he'll also bless your increase. He says the fruit of your body. I guess if you're like a hard laborer like Dion, you know, he'll give you strength, you know, if you keep his commandments. It says the fruit of thy ground. If you're a farmer, you know, he'll bless the fruit of the ground. It says he'll bless the fruit of the cattle. He'll make them nice and fat. It says the increase of thy kind and the flocks of thy sheep. Blessed shalt thy basket and thy store be. He'll bless your savings. But see, we need to keep his commandments, okay? And this is not a sermon to go over all the commandments. But if you hearken unto the voice of the Lord and you cry after knowledge, you should have no problem understanding what this is talking about, okay? Now, that was point number two. Why should I fear the Lord? Number one, to keep his commandments. But number two, for blessings. And the third is for our children. Okay? Go to Hosea 4. Hosea 4. Hosea 4. This is a big one, so I'm just waiting for everyone to get there. Okay? This is something that really, I forgot about this verse, but luckily God brought it to me and I remembered it. It says in Hosea 4, starting in verse 6, it says, "My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Because thou hast rejected knowledge, I will also reject thee, that thou shalt be no priest to me. Seeing thou hast forgotten the law of thy God, I will also forget thy children." See, we learn that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. And these people, it says, "My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Because thou hast rejected knowledge, I will also reject thee." And then he also says, "I'll forget thy children." I don't want God to forget my kid. I only have one right now. She's not very old, but I don't want God to forget her. And we should not only strive to keep the commandments to please God and to get blessings, but we should also strive and keep the commandments and follow the law of God for our kids. Because, you know, it's up to Liam to pass this buck when we're done. It's up to the kids in here. You know, we're all going to die, right? But it's up to the kids to keep going, to keep this torch on fire and to keep moving. And the reason I want to please God is so that my kids will pass the torch and teach their kids and to keep this thing going for as long as God sees fit. I know, I mean, I do think that we're in the end times, or at least in the very, very start of it. But even if we're not, you know, it's up to our kids to keep this going. Not me. I'm going to die. It's up to our kids to keep this going. It's up to our kids to keep churches like Old Path alive. You know, once we're gone and once we're old. I mean, I'm still going to be alive one day, but I'm going to be too old to soul win. Hopefully my kids will soul win. But it's up to our kids in the future to keep that going. And that's why it's important for us to fear God and to keep his commandments. Because it's not up to me, it's not up to Brother Charlie, it's not up to Brother Rob or Matt to keep this going when we get too old. It's up to our kids. And I don't want God to forget our kids, okay? So that was point number three. That's a big point. I don't want God to forget our kids. I think there's a song out there. It's a worldly song. I'm not suggesting to listen to it, but it says kids of the future. I mean, it's the truth. We're all going to die one day. So Proverbs 10. Go to Proverbs 10. Proverbs 10. Proverbs 10, the fourth point I want to make is it'll prolong your days. Okay? Just like obeying your parents prolongs your days, fearing the Lord prolongs your days. It says in Proverbs 10, verse 27, it says, the fear of the Lord prolongeth days, but the years of the wicked shall be shortened. Pretty cut and dry. I don't really have much to say about it. I think it says it all right there. The fear of the Lord prolongeth days. That's that point. That one's done. Pretty clear. Now, the fifth point I want to make is in Psalms 56. Psalm 56. It says, "In God will I praise his word," starting in verse 10, sorry. Psalm 56, verse 10. "In God will I praise his word. In the Lord will I praise his word. In God have I put my trust. I will not be afraid what man can do unto me." So last point I want to make on why I should fear the Lord, it's a reminder in persecution. When we are getting hated, when people are calling us evil and of the devil, and that's not even really persecution, but when people are tying us up, and when people are trying to get a testimony for us, we need to stand on God's word. See, God can destroy our lives way easier than a man can destroy our life. If someone wants to tie me up and put me against a wall, whip me till I bleed to death, I will never have a testimony for this world. Never. Because I fear God. Because I care more about what God thinks. And even though I might be bleeding and dying, we ought to care more about what God thinks. Because, yeah, God sees us sitting there and he's crying for us. He's not happy that we're on that wall getting beat or whatever. We're about to get our head chopped off, whatever the case may be. We need to fear what God thinks in that moment. Amen. Not what man is about to do to me. Oh, he's going to whip me for the 50th time. Who cares? You know, the Bible teaches that we get a crown when we're persecuted. He teaches that we'll get better. I mean, I preached on it a while ago in my little 10-minute sermon. But we ought to fear God rather than man. And that's just, if you don't, you know, like we went over, you're going to fail. And you're going to give in. And you're going to fall away. Okay? And you're going to be very, very sorry for yourself when you give in. I guarantee it. When you're a martyr and you have an opportunity to testify for Jesus and you don't. Because you're scared about what man's going to do. You're going to be very sorry for yourself, and God's going to be sorry for you too. I guarantee it. Proverbs 10, we just read it. Where am I at here? And even in the first passage that we read in Matthew 10, he straight up said, "Don't fear man, fear God. Fear him that is able to cast body and soul in hell." And so, That's pretty much it. That's why we should fear God. That's all the things that I could come up with in the short amount of time studying this. So let's talk about the last thing, or one of the last things I want to talk about, is when should I fear the Lord? Okay, I think it's pretty obvious through this whole thing is that fearing the Lord is not just like an one-off occasion. You should fear the Lord every single day. And whenever we read that passage, we should read every day. Fearing the Lord is an everyday growing process. Every day. It says, the Lord is pleased when we keep his commandments. He's pleased when we read his word, when we rebuke wickedness, when we stand for his word. These are all things that we should do every day, not just because you're having a good day. You know, you think you're filled with the Spirit one day. You should always do these things, and you should always, always, always want to please God. Now, I think it's obvious these are all things that we should strive for. I think it's very clear, and I hope I made it clear, that this is something we should strive for. Now, last thing, this is my last page of notes here. It says, one of the points I want to make is that people will hate you for fearing God. That's what we read in Matthew 10, but the Bible says in John 3, if you want to turn there, I'll let you all turn there, John 3, that one should be really easy to find. John 3. Verse 19. It says, "And this is the condemnation, that light is come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For everyone that doeth evil hateth the light, neither cometh to the light, lest his deeds shall be reproved. But he that doeth truth cometh to the light, that his deeds may be made manifest, that they are wrought in God. So we see here that everyone that doeth evil hateth the light. People who are wicked and evil are going to hate whenever you try to reprove or rebuke what they're guilty of. And people are going to hate you for it. People are going to hate you for keeping his commandments and soul winning and doing what you're supposed to do and rebuking wickedness and hating wickedness. But throughout this whole thing, we've seen that the fear of the Lord is clean, and we shouldn't worry about that. We should have no worry at all for what people say about what we believe the Bible says. If we are preaching the Bible, we have no need to worry about what anybody says. And that's kind of the basis of this whole sermon. And turn to Matthew 10, where we started. It's just that we need not fear man. Man cannot do anything to us. If God's on our side, how can we fail? I think it's something that us as Christians really, really, really need to hone in on. Because we are reaching a time of serious persecution. And all of us need to be ready. And we need to be mentally and spiritually ready. And we also need to know how to get ready. And this is something that all of us should be ready for. If we go to this church, we need to be ready for anything like what's been going on with Verity Baptist Church in Sacramento last year. That's only a fraction. It's not even a fraction of what is to come. The Bible, we know what the Bible says. We're going to be brought into synagogues in front of governors, and they're going to ask for a testimony. And they're going to try and kill us. And they're going to try and persecute us to get us to fall back. This persecution, if we had protesters, that's nothing. Protesters are nothing. And that's why Pastor Menez wasn't even fazed. But there's going to be a time when there are people who literally want to just kick this door down and hurt us. It's going to happen. And there are going to be people, maybe even in this room, who don't stick around. I guarantee you. There's going to be people who leave this church because of persecution. It happened at Verity. And that wasn't even a fraction, a toenail clipping. That wasn't even the whole thing. We haven't even gotten there yet. And men are already fearing man. They're fearing their job. They're fearing their house, their neighbors, whatever the case. But we haven't even gotten there yet. It hasn't even happened yet. And you're leaving your church because your boss. You're leaving your church because, oh, I don't know if I can feed my family. Didn't God say he was going to provide? See, we need to fear God because God, ultimately, he has ultimate say about what happens to our life. If we perish, we perish. I don't care. I really don't care. If someone wants to come in here, kick this door down, and shoot me, if I perish, I perish. If I die, I die. But the thing is that we have so many limp-wrist Christians who I believe say they're Christians but are not, kind of like the Jews that say they're Jews and are not. These people are not Christian. They don't fear God. And these people are just going to evaporate. They're not going to call themselves Christians anymore because real Christians are going to be executed. Real Christians are going to stand on the Bible. Real Christians are going to say, "Thus saith the Lord." And these Christians are just going to evaporate. They're going to cease to exist. And these kind of churches are going to be the last ones standing. The soul winning, fire breathing, "Thus saith the Lord" churches are going to be the only ones left. And it's up to you whether or not you stay. It's up to you whether or not you fear God enough to stay. Or you fear man. Which one is it? That's what it's going to come down to. Do you fear God or do you fear death? Do you fear God or do you fear your job? Do you fear God or do you fear some Muslim coming in here and shooting me? What is it? It's a big deal. So we're in Matthew 10. This is the last thing. We're coming around the horse. Matthew 10, starting in verse 22. It says, "And you shall be hated of all men for my name's sake, but he that endureth to the end shall be saved. But when they persecute you in this city, flee into another one. For verily I say unto you, ye shall not have gone over the city of Israel till the Son of Man be come." The disciple is not above his master, nor the servant above his Lord. It is enough for the disciple that he be as his master, and the servant as his Lord. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebub, how much more shall they call them of his own household? Fear them not, therefore, for there is nothing covered that shall not be revealed, and hid that shall not be known. What I tell you in darkness, that speak ye in light, and what ye hear in the ear, that preach ye upon the housetops. And fear not them which kill the body, but are not able to kill the soul, but rather fear him which is able to destroy both soul and body in hell. Let's read, go on to verse 34. It says, "Think not that I have come to send peace on the earth. I came not to send peace, but a sword. For I am come to set a man at variance against his father, and the daughter against her mother, and the daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. And the man foes shall be they of his own household. He that loveth father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And he that loveth son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And he that taketh not his cross and followeth after me is not worthy of me. He that findeth his life shall lose it. And he that looseth his life for my sake shall find it. He that receiveth you receiveth me, and he that receiveth me receiveth him that sent me." See, once I did this study, this passage, because in other passages it says hate your father and your mother, and that always kind of confused me. But this passage, once I did this study, it kind of showed me some things. It says, "Think not that I have come to send peace on the earth. I come not to send peace, but a sword." And then it says in verse 36, "And a man's foes shall be they of his own household." I have a ton of family who probably is going to scold me for this sermon and tell me, "Oh, well, it's too much hate. You gotta love everybody." But it says in verse 37, "He that loveth his father and mother more than me is not worthy of me." See, if I cared more about what my mom and dad thought about this, I'm not worthy. If I cared more about what people are going to say to me on social media, I think that's what it's talking about. You know, we ought to love God's word more than our parents' word. We ought to love, you know, we ought to fear God, not man, okay? And that's it. Let's have a word of prayer, okay?